Bismillah, walhamdulillah, my dear sisters and my brothers, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. This is your brother Abdusalam. Today I have a very, very surprising, and I'm sure you've never heard of this fact that I'm going to mention right now. Not because it doesn't exist. Allah has spoken about it in the Qur'an many times. It's just the way Islam has been laid down to us and how we follow Islam, the hadith narratives, the sheikh, the scholar, the school of thoughts, books of history. Everybody is listened to except what we should listen to in the first place, the Qur'an. One of those facts that once you understand, you will be happy that you are a Muslim today. And I will lay it down right here. And then we will talk about it, because it's going to surprise you. Really, it's going to surprise you to no end. Here it is. Al-Islam, as we know it today, was not meant for the entire world. It was not meant for the Romans. It was not meant for the Persians. It was not meant for the Egyptians, not the North Africans, the Germans, English, Italians, Spanish. It was not at all. It was meant for the Arabs and the Arabs all alone. You're going to stop me going, hey, hang on. Allah has clearly said in the Quran that He has sent the messenger as a mercy to mankind. Someone else who has read the Quran would say, hey, hang on. Allah has stated in the Quran that He had sent the messenger to all mankind. And I would answer, no. Allah did not, and Allah didn't say that He sent the messenger to all mankind. In fact, Allah was very specific about to whom He sent the messenger with the Quran. I will, if you bear with me, inshallah, we will go through the things, and once you understand how Allah speaks about and what He speaks about in the Quran, you'll understand that actually we have been following a parallel religion. This is why all the sheikhs, the scholar of thought, the scholars, everybody has done everything they could to keep Al-Quran away from the main, being the main player in Al-Islam. Reason being, because Al-Quran is talking completely different things. But here it is. One of the ayat in Al-Quran where Allah says in Surah Al-A'raf, this is Surah number 7, the ayah is 158, where Allah orders the messenger to say the following, قُلْ يَا أَيُّهَا النَّاسِ إِنِّي رَسُولُ اللَّهِ إِلَيْكُمْ جَمِيعًا. Say, O you people, I am indeed a messenger of Allah to you all. You're going to say to me, there you go. That's the evidence that the Quran, the messenger of Allah, was sent to all mankind. If you look at the English translations, you would find them translated annas. Annas in Arabic is the people in front of you. If you have a room full of people, these are the nas, the people. You are insan, one person insan. The plural of insan, one single human, are nas. But you know, they're translated into oh humanity. In another translation, O mankind. In a third translation, it says just O man. The truth is, for this statement to be true, i.e. where the Prophet Muhammad, the messenger of Allah, would address the people, the messenger of Allah should and would have spoken to the entire humanity on earth in a language they all understood. He's dead now. How can he speak to the English of today? How could he have spoken to the French of 5 centuries ago? And this also means that the entire earth should have spoken Arabic and have lived in Mecca or Medina. But guess what? They didn't. And as we know it already, the only people to have lived in Mecca and Medina were the Arabs. And those who were not Arabs, but actually they did speak the Arabic and lived with the Arabs, the Jews and Christians and different Persians, Romans and people who from other places that happened to be in Arabia. Just like today, I'm not an English person at all. But I have lived in England and for so long, and I speak the language, I'm of the culture. Guess what? I am counted one of amongst them, but I am not one of them. Exactly at the time of the messenger. They were the Arabs, and they were the Jews, the Christians, the Persians, the other people who are not, who were not Arabs, but they happened to live with the Arabs. They spoke the language and interacted with the Arabs. The ayah that I just read to you, where the messenger of Allah says, "O you people," is part of a bigger ayah in a bigger context. And as I said before so many times, as soon as you cut one ayah from its context, you can use it virtually for anything. You can actually turn something haram into halal and something halal into a haram. And this, the sheikhs, the school of thoughts, and all these people have completely done very good at it. They cut an ayah from the context and they take 2-3 words from it, and guess what? They apply it for you, and until now our Islam has become a hellfire upon us. So the ayah that I just read for you, where the messenger of Allah says that, "O people, I'm indeed a messenger of Allah," was not an individual ayah, but it was within a context. You see, when the Qur'an was descended on the messenger with the purpose, the sole purpose, it was descended on a human being so that he delivers it to the human being living with him. You see, and because the Jews and Christians and other people who spoke Arabic, when Allah wanted them to be amongst those the Qur'an was sent down to and that he was speaking to, Allah Ta'ala used terminologies and used a language that the people of the book who were living at the time of Muhammad could understand Allah was talking to them. After all, the Jews had lived with the Arabs in the Arabian Peninsula for centuries and have become almost like the Arabs, except that they kept their identity and beliefs alive and they practiced them. You see, the Jews had thought of themselves very excluded from the message that was sent by Allah to Muhammad. After all, they are the chosen people of Allah. They have the Torah. They follow Moses. But to include them and the Christian into this message, and that's why Allah specifically speaks about the people of the book, not about the Buddhists, not about the Sikh, not about the Hindus, not about, he speaks about the people of the book, because Al-Quran, the Torah, and the Gospel, the Injil, are one book, is just in different languages, and Allah Ta'ala changes here and there, but the final of them, all the updated version, was Al-Quran. When you look at the context in which this ayah say, "I am a messenger, O people, I am the messenger to you all," we need to go to Surah Al-A'raf, that is Surah number 7, even though this ayah is 158. But actually, the context of this ayah starts from ayah 103. When Allah speaks about him sending Moses to Pharaoh in Egypt so that he takes the children of Israel from Egypt to the promised land. And that topic goes on until 168 and beyond. So it's over 65 ayat that speak about a context. But when we just truncate and we cut a small portion of an ayah from the context, it could mean anything. And as we shall see right now, that meaning is actually very detrimental, very dangerous, and very misleading. You see, Allah reminded the children of Israel of their story from the moment he sent Moses to Pharaoh to Egypt. And why did he do that? Because he wanted the people who lived in Al-Madinah, who lived in the Arabian Peninsula, to be concerned, to be spoken to. Allah means them as well. And I will just mention a couple ayat just to bring in the context into question. While Musa was away for the 40 days to hold counsel with Allah to receive the Torah by the Mount Sinai, the Jews, as you know, were left with Aaron. And what did they do? They chose to ignore the instruction of Musa and Harun, and they went astray and they worshiped the calf. When Moses came back after the 40 days and he saw what they did, he got extremely upset and threw the tablets away. And those tablets were written the text of the Torah, the Ten Commandments. Long story short, Musa made a dua, a very specific dua to Allah. He said, "Waktub lana fi hadhihi dunya hasanatan wa fil akhirah." Ya Allah, write for us, the believers in that moment there, in this life and in the hereafter, a goodness from you. Of course, the goodness is Jannah. Inna hudna ilayk. We have turned back, or we have become Jew. To be a Jew means to be someone who repents to Allah. The Arabic term, ya'ud, in the Jewish term is Yahud. As you can see, it's the same thing. It's just the difference of the A and Ha. And they mean return to Allah or repent to Allah. When Moses or Musa made this dua to Allah to write it for them in this life and in the hereafter a goodness, Allah answered him back and he said, قَالَ عَذَابِي أُصِيبُ بِهِ مَنْ أَشَاءُ. My punishment, my torment, I will inflict it upon whom I will. So punishment, Allah chooses whom to punish. But then he reveals something absolutely beautiful. وَرَحْمَتِي وَسِعَتْ كُلَّ شَيْءٍ. And my mercy, my forgiveness, actually encompasses everything. Meaning, no matter what the number of creation of Allah, humans or jinn or anything else, if we all sin the 24 hours a day non-stop and we take the biggest sin ever, Allah will still forgive us because His forgiveness is a huge ball in which you can put all sins of humanity and it will take them. But this mercy, this forgiveness, Allah will give it to specific people. فَسَأَكْتُبُهَا لِلَّذِينَ يَتَّقُونَ وَيُؤْتُونَ الزَّكَاةِ. I will write it, this mercy, for those who are mindful of God. And they do lots of acts of purifying charity. Any good deed that you do for humanity is a purifying act of charity. So here ends the conversation between Allah and Moses. Then Allah speaking to the Jews in Al-Madina at the time of Prophet Muhammad, he tells them, of course, after he has said that, it's still relevant, then he speaks to the Jews directly and tells them, وَالَّذِينَ هُمْ بِآيَاتِنَا يُؤْمِنُونَ. And those who today, they believe in the descended ayat revealed in the Qur'an. So Allah is inviting here the Jews of the time, as I said, of the time of Muhammad, to believe in Al-Quran. And so that he doesn't leave anything unclear, so that those people, and this, what I'm saying now is relevant to the people who lived at the time of the messenger. The Jews who live in our time now are excluded from this because they weren't there. Allah is talking to the, had the Jews at the time of Prophet Muhammad believed, results would have been different now. But the misguidance, the misdeed that the first Jews did, the first Christians did, they shall bear the consequences of that. The Jews of today, the Christians of today, have absolutely nothing except that they follow what they have been brought up to. If you or myself were born to a Jewish family or Christian family, and since our day one we were told that Jesus is Son of God, when we believe that and we do our best at being good religious, why would Allah put me in hellfire for eternity when it is our parents who educated me, who themselves were educated, who themselves, the grandfathers and so on and so on, until you go back to these people who were at the time of the messenger, they should have believed in the book that Allah revealed then. They didn't believe, they bear what they have done, the responsibility, and the results of what they have done. So Allah is talking to the Jews at the time of the messenger. You cannot, certainly not, we cannot go to a Jewish person now and we give him the Quran and we say you believe in the Quran or you are a disbeliever. We cannot do that. There is more into that than just giving a book to someone and expect them to believe. It's just like a Buddhist who comes to you, gives you their mantras and tells you, you believe in them or you are a kafir and I will kill you. Doesn't work like that. It really doesn't work that. So Allah says, وَالَّذِينَ هُمْ بِآيَاتِنَا يُؤْمِنُونَ. So Allah invites the Jews at the time of Muhammad to believe in the Quran as a descended text, and they have lived with the messenger. They could see, they have lived all the events at that time there. And then Allah wants to pinpoint, as I said, who he was talking to and who he was talking about. He tells them, الَّذِينَ, those of the people of the book, who would follow الرَّسُول, النَّبِيَّ الْأُمِّي, those who would follow the messenger, Muhammad, the Gentile prophet. You see, Gentile to a Jewish person means anyone who is not a Jew. In this ayah, Allah states that Muhammad is not a Jewish person. He is not the Messiah that they are waiting for. But rather, he is an Arab, non-Jewish. It doesn't mean that the one who doesn't read or write, as they say it, Muhammad, Gentile, al-Ummi here doesn't mean that Muhammad was ignorant. Because Allah in the Quran has stated that the Messenger of Allah did read and write. The books of history, the hadith narratives told you that he didn't. Why? So that the Quran becomes miracle. If that was the case, why didn't Allah use that for the Quran? Being an ignorant person who doesn't read and write was the norm back then. It was the norm back then. Rasulullah, according to the Quran, did read and write, and I will, inshallah, speak about this another day. So Allah here tells them that you, the Jews and Christians, you follow the non-Gentile, the Gentile prophet, who is non-Jewish and non. And then Allah says, الَّذِي يَجِدُونَهُ مَكْتُوبًا عِنْدَهُمْ فِي التَّوْرَاتِ وَالْإِنْجِيلِ. The description of this messenger can be found in the Torah and in Injil, in the Gospel. And this messenger is not going to ask them to do anything different than what they did before. He will command them, يُؤْمُرُهُمْ بِالْمَعْرُوفِ. He will command them to do that which is known to be good, and will forbid them from doing that which is evil. And this is normal. And then he tells them, وَيُحِلُّ لَهُمُ الطَّيِّبَاتِ وَيُحَرِّمُ عَلَيْهِمْ الْخَبَائِثِ. He makes halal for them the good, and makes haram to them what is impure. This ayah is always used also to say, oh, you see, the messenger can make things halal or haram, when in fact that is not what Allah is saying to the Jews and the Christians. He is not telling them out of his head Muhammad will start making things halal or haram. No, he will apply what Allah is saying, is that when the Prophet Muhammad, when my messenger that I sent to you, makes something halal or tells you something is halal, which originally in the Torah was, and you know, was haram, but when he tells it to you, it's halal, it didn't come out from his mind. He didn't just tell it to you like that. He says that because I said it to him in the Quran. That's all it means. And when the messenger of Allah would forbid something on the children of Israel, being Jews or Christian, it didn't come out of his own mind. What Allah is telling them is, I told him, that's why he tells you. But anyhow, and then what the messenger of Allah carries on, وَيَضَعُ عَنْهُمْ إِسْرَهُمْ, and the messenger would relieve them from their burdens and the shackles that bound them. How will he do that? In the Quran. And this is why Allah ends this ayah by saying, فَالَّذِينَ آمَنُوا بِهِ, as for those who believe in him, being a messenger of Allah, and on top of that shall honor and support him, and وَاتَّبَعُوا النُّورَ الَّذِي أُنزِلَ مَعَهُ, and follow the light, the Quran, which was sent down with him. And then guess what? Such are the successful. In order for the people of the book to believe in Muhammad as a messenger sent to them as well. And of course, if they did that, consequently believe in the Quran as a descended book for them. And this, they needed to hear it clearly, without any shadow of doubt. And for this to take place, Allah orders his messenger to shout it out loud to those who could see and hear him, those people who lived with him in Al-Madina, Jews, Christian, Persian, everybody. He gathered them all and he says, oh, you people, I am indeed a messenger of Allah to you, pointing to them all. He was not talking to the people living in the 21st century. He was talking to his people, to the people who lived with him. And then he carried on saying, الَّذِي لَهُ مُلْكُ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ, the one, so the messenger is sent by Allah to all those who were with him, from whom the one who has the ownership of the heavens and the earth. La ilaha illa huwa yuhyi wa yumit, no other deity to be worshipped other than him. He grants life and death. And then Allah now, and this end of what Muhammad said, now Allah carries on saying, he says, فَآمِنُوا بِاللَّهِ وَرَسُولِهِ النَّبِيِّ الْأُمِّي, so believe in Allah and in the envoy he sent to you, the Gentile, i.e. the Arab, the non-Jew prophet. And then Allah says, this prophet is not any different than Moses and those and Jesus and those who came before him. He believes in the same God, Allah, as you do, and in the same words are in the Torah and the Gospel as you do. Meaning this Arab prophet or messenger that I sent, he shares in your belief, and you share in his belief, and you are a lot similar. He is not asking you to believe in something you never heard of. It's not like Muhammad was a Buddhist and he came suddenly asking the Jews and Christians to believe. No. We, the Jews and Christians, if we spoke about Allah, what Allah wants to be a believer, we're not different. Speak to a Jew and Christian, you believe in God? Of course we do. Do you, angels? Yes. The books? Yes. The last day? Yes. Things like that. And that's that. We should have gone like that way. But we didn't. And that is because of the past. As I said when I began, of course, if you want to read more about this ayah, you can, about the whole story, read please Surah Al-A'raf, that is Surah 7, from ayah 104 and all the way until Allah finishes talking to the children of Israel. And then it is, this is why Allah says to them, وَاتَّبِعُوا, and follow Muhammad. Maybe you shall be guided and you reach guidance. Alhamdulillah. As I said earlier on when I began, that Islam was for the Arabs and the Arabs only. Islam should never ever have left the Arabian Peninsula. I know this is surprising to you, and I know it's, you are confused right now, right? But you shouldn't. That is because what Allah says in the Quran is completely out of touch. I don't know. At times we don't believe in the Quran. Wallahi al-Azim. Look what Allah speaks to Muhammad in Surah Ibrahim. Surah Ibrahim is the Surah number 14. And it was revealed completely, totally in Mecca. In the ayah number 4, if you have the Quran, opening up, if you don't speak Arabic, that's okay. You will find the translation and I will say something about that. Allah speaks to Muhammad and also speaks to Quraysh, and he tells them, وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَا مِنْ رَسُولٍ, and we never ever sent a messenger, إِلَّا بِلِسَانِ قَوْمِهِ, except with the language of his own people. Meaning, if the people are Arabs, Allah will not send them an English messenger, he will send them an Arab. If the people are Persians, they speak Farsi, Allah will not send them an Arab, he will send them a Persian. Whatever the people are from, whatever language they speak, when Allah sends a messenger, that messenger has to speak their own language. Why? Because Allah will use that human messenger to transmit Allah's message to them in a language that they understand. And this is why Allah justified this act when he said, لِيُبَيِّنَ لَهُمْ, so that he makes the message of Allah clear to them. Imagine Muhammad was not an Arab, but imagine he was in English. The Quran revealed to him was Arabic. Now imagine an English person who doesn't speak Arabic at all receives the Quran in Arabic. How is he gonna tell it to us? How is he gonna tell us what Allah has sent? Imagine if the Quran was in French and the messenger was an Arab, a Bedouin from Arabia. How is he going to speak French? And how are the French people who speak well the language, how are they going to understand in French or in English or anything from other from their one of their own. This is why Allah always, always chooses the messenger to speak the language of the people he sends to them. Once the message is made clear to the people, then people are one of the two. They decide what to do with that message. They agree with it, they accept it, and once they do that, they want to be guided. Guess what? Then Allah guides them to that. He helps them. And if they want to turn away, Allah will make them turn away, because Allah at the end of the day executes our wishes. When you want to, you sit in, you're watching the television and you want to change channel, you want to grab the remote control, press on the next channel, right? Guess what? You think of the act, you wish for it, you intend for it. For you to be able to do the act, that is what Allah creates. If Allah doesn't create the act, it will not happen. And this is why Allah says that it is Allah who guides and misguides, not Him who causes guidance. No, you choose. If you choose to be guided, guess what? And you do what you want to do for it, Allah creates what you want. Allah only creates what you want. And this is the real meaning of this, what is mentioned in Surah As-Saffat, Surah number 31, in the ayah 96, where Allah speaks to people on the tongue of Ibrahim when He tells them, "Wallahu khalaqakum," and Allah created you, "wama ta'malun," and your actions, i.e., you intend. It's not that Allah created the actions before and you do what Allah created. It's the other way around. You wish for the actions, and guess what? Then Allah creates it. Look at it this way: you are you, and the computer is what makes your action. When you want to write a letter, you intend to write a letter. You intend to press the A. And when you press on the A on your keyboard, the computer translates your wishes into an action. That is Allah. Allah only translates the actions into your thoughts into actions. So when Allah says in Al-Quran that whenever He sends a messenger, He sends him in the language of His own people. Now tell me, the Egyptians didn't speak Arabic. They speak their Coptic language. Muhammad was not sent to them. They are not Arabs. The Romans didn't speak Arabic. Muhammad was not sent to them. The Persians didn't speak Arabic. Muhammad was not meant for them. North Africans, the Berbers, the Amazigh people, the Southern Africa, the world over, they didn't speak Arabic. Muhammad was sent to a people who spoke Arabic and Arabic only. That should have been where Islam should have been. And this is, that's why this, you never get to hear about this. Reason being, how did Islam spread then? Why was Islam? Well, I will tell you at the end of this talk why Islam and why this truth is kept away from you. Now, you can ask this question. So, Allah had chosen the children of Israel, who is, one of the children of Ibrahim to be, he gave them the Torah. And the children of Ismail, He gives them the Quran. What about the rest of humanity? Why should they? Are they going to go to hellfire just because Allah didn't send a message to them? Well, Allah has answered that question. It's just, again, we don't pay attention to that. And the sheikhs do not speak about that. And I will tell you why all this is kept hush-hush and under the table kind of stuff. Allah says in Al-Quran in Surah Fatir. Surah Fatir, and this is Surah number 35 in the ayah 24. Allah says this, وَإِن مِّنْ أُمَّةٍ, and there is not a single community, a single nation on earth, إِلَّا خَلَى فِيهَا نَذِيرٍ, except a warner has passed through it, has been sent to them, i.e. anywhere you go on earth, the Incas, or you go to the Native Americans, the Indians, or you anywhere you go on earth, except they have a religion, people believe in something. That something is some warner, some messengers that Allah had sent before. And that's why Allah chose the progeny of Abraham over others. Prophets didn't only come from Ibrahim, but they came from all kinds. Not a single nation has existed on earth that Allah didn't send a warner to. Otherwise, on Judgment Day, anyone can suddenly, someone who didn't get any message would wake up and we find, oh, what's this? Judgment Day? What the heck is Judgment Day? I thought we just die and end of it. They go, oh, no, the angels will tell them, oh, no, you got it all wrong, man. There is a Judgment Day and you are in deep trouble. Why? Because you didn't believe in a Quran sent in Arabic. Arab what? Arabic. Who, Muhammad? Where is this Muhammad? Where? In Arabia? What the heck is that? Saudi Arabia, oh, where the tyrants, where they kill Jamal Khashoggi and they kill people, they behead them, is that the people? Am I supposed to believe in that religion? You see how things can go wrong? What we were supposed to be doing is this. Allah has sent the Quran to the Arabs. They should have followed the Quran, kept it to themselves, leave the other people and their beliefs until Judgment Day comes in and Allah decides who goes what, because Allah knows why we are the way we are. You see, the Messenger of Allah, Muhammad, understood this. That's why he didn't go in conquering the lands and he didn't go and take the lands, even the Holy Land. The Holy Land, which today they say Palestine, but it's not. It's a bigger picture than that. He didn't go there. If it was the right of Muslims to be in the Holy Land, Muhammad would have gone first. He would never, ever have... Allah would have told him, Muhammad, go capture Jerusalem. Take it. Muhammad didn't do that. You see, that the only thing that got Islam out of the Arabian Peninsula are politics and the desire to expand an empire. You see, the Arabs of back in time, some 1,400, almost 1,500 years ago, they were people who lived in a place and they were affected by what was going on back then. They could see the Romans, they became a superpower. Guess what the Romans did? They expanded Byzantium, Persia, all these, when you read about them, when you become powerful, you take the lands of other people, you force them to do what you want. When the Arabs had this religion, and suddenly they were strong, what was the next step? Force the entire world, turn it into an imperium, an imperial state. Even though Allah has explicitly and clearly stated that no one should ever be forced to believe in him or in his descended books, that the belief in him and in his religion and everything is 100% free will choice that humans, any human on earth, can practice. It is the hadith narratives and the man of religion that painted a complete different pictures about Islam, a picture full of compulsion and bloodshedding, which consequences are still felt until now and will never disappear as long as we keep practicing the hadithic Islam. Allah in Al-Quran has explained many times no compulsion. Here are just two narratives from the hadiths, because I don't want to make this such a long talk, where the contradiction, where the hadith says opposite, 100%, opposite, Al-Quran says go right, the hadith says go left. What did our sheikhs, the scholars and politics go? They went with the hadith. They abandoned the Quran. They actually went ahead and justified, falsified, forged, turned the meaning of what Allah beautifully said in Al-Quran. And they followed in the hadith pathway. Why? Because they believe the hadith equals the Quran. And this is the hugest problem we're facing today and will always face. Listen to this hadith narrative. أمرت أن أقاتل الناس حتى يشهدوا أن لا إله إلا الله وأن محمد رسول الله. This is Muhammad talking, the message of Allah. I have been ordered. Who orders Muhammad? Allah. He says, I have been ordered to go to war against the people, i.e. all people on earth here, till they testify that there is no other deity worth of worship except Allah, and that Muhammad is the messenger of Allah. I.e. Muhammad is in a state of war with every human being, unless and until they become Muslims. And then he goes, not only that, وَيُقِيمُ الصَّلَاةَ وَيُؤْتُ الزَّكَاةَ, and that they should establish the daily prayers and pay the zakat. And then he said, فَإِذَا فَعَلُوا عَصَمُوا مِنِّي دِمَاءَهُمْ وَأَمْوَالَهُمْ إِلَّا بِحَقِّهَا. So if they say La ilaha illallah and they believe in me as a messenger of Allah, they perform the salat and they do the zakat, so if they do all that, then their blood and their property are secured from me except by the rights of Islam. What it means here by the rights of Islam, should they leave Islam, then their blood and their property come back to me. وَحِسَابُهُمْ عَلَى اللَّهِ, and their accountability is left to Allah. I'm going to explode. It is in Bukhari and in Muslim and others. This is why Muslims today feel and believe that they are the believers. Everyone else, a part of them, is kafir. And as you can see, according to this authentic, as authentic them, to me is a pure lie. To me, it's a huge pure lie. But according to this authentic hadith narrative, the messenger of Allah and after him the believers are in a continuous state of war against the entire humanity until either we force them to believe in Allah and do as we please, or we annihilate all of them. If they don't do, it's death to everybody else. This hadith narrative, not the Quran, this hadith narrative is what makes the Muslims believe again of themselves as the only believers on earth while everyone else is kafir and kuffar, and this is shaitan speaking. This is untrue. Look at what Allah says in Al-Quran, and look at what the hadith narrative say, and judge for yourself. Allah addressing here Muhammad himself. He tells him, وَلَوْ شَاءَ رَبُّكَ. In case you hear some meowing, my kitten has, two of my female cats have given birth, so I have all this background chorale, choir supporting my talk. But anyhow, Allah addresses Muhammad. He tells him, and this surah was revealed in Mecca, when the messenger of Allah so wished that people would embrace Islam just like you and me, would love to see the entire Muslim follow the Quran and the Quran alone, no manipulation, no fabrication of hadith, nothing. But it's not in our hands. Listen and look to what Allah tells Muhammad and compare that with what the hadith says. Muhammad said, look at that. وَلَوْ شَاءَ رَبُّكَ. And if your Lord, yeah, Muhammad, he's talking to Muhammad here, and if your Lord has wanted, or willed, لَآمَنَ مَنْ فِي الْأَرْضِ كُلُّهُمْ جَمِيعًا, then everyone on earth would have believed, all of them together. But what Allah is saying to Muhammad, but Allah hasn't wanted, Allah hasn't willed, Allah doesn't force people into believing. He sends them messengers, books of guidance, warns them, promises them great rewards. The only one thing that Allah doesn't do is force people. This is why he tells his messenger, if I don't force them, I can force the entire earth to become believers in one go, but I don't do it. أَفَا أَنْتَ تُكْرِهُ النَّاسِ. Then, ya Muhammad, are you the one who is compelling, who is going to compel people until they become believers? Are you the one? You have no possibility, you have no power. I can't do it. I'm a god. In a swoop of split of a second, I can decide that everybody would believe at the same moment. But I don't do it. I don't force people. You, Muhammad, are you the one who's going to force them? This you can read in Surah number 10, Ayah number 99. But the evil hadith and the lies invented by the crooks, the shaitan sheikhs of before, tells you that the messenger says, I was ordered to go to war against the people until they say, against the, and Allah tells him they will not. And then you see the headache that we are in? Allah has said in Al-Quran, لا إكراه في الدين. Let there be no compulsion in religion. There is no compulsion. There is no forcing in belief. This is Surah 2, Ayah number 256. Here is another hadith that tells you that there is compulsion on hadith. That we Muslims must compel people. We must force people to believe. If they don't, we kill them. This hadith of this story also exists in Bukhari, Muslim. And when I say Bukhari and Muslim, I'm telling you that this is what the sheikhs worship. As soon as you say Bukhari and Muslim, there is no shadow of doubt in their head that what you are telling them is truth, is revelation, blah, blah, blah. The Quran, there is no Bukhari and Muslim. It's not narrated by Bukhari and Muslim. And as such, it's okay. We can disregard it. But the hadith, no. Listen to this. It's a very worrying incident. This hadith is known in Arabic, Dhi-al-Khalasa, or Dhi-al-Khalasa. Dhi-al-Khalasa is a house. There was a tribe called Khatham. Khatham is a tribe in Al-Yemen. So it's very far from Mecca, from Medina. Very, really, really far. But anyhow, Khatham had a house, like a church, like a place. And in that house, they had some statues that they used to worship. When the messenger heard of this, Allah al-Azim, it's even shameful to, but this is what Islam is built upon, so you need to know these things. So the messenger sent somebody called Jarir. Jarir is one of the believers there, all right? He sent him as a commander over 150 well-armed knights. And when they say knights back then, it's like today, I tell you, he sent him with 150 war planes, or the ship, the mother ships, you know, I forgot the name of how you call them, but America has got fleet, yeah, the fleets. He sent them superpower. So he sent him, what is the purpose of this? He sent him, yeah, Jarir, go destroy, go knock down that house in which Allah is worshipped, other than Allah is worshipped. Okay, then this man takes the 150 well-armed knights and heads all the way to Yemen. You're talking about hundreds, if not thousands of miles away. But anyway, when he arrives there, he gets and annihilates the entire house. With everything in it, with the goddess, with everything that the people there didn't receive Islam for. It's not like you forced them into Islam and then they went back. No, they just didn't hear of that. But hey, guess what? It's compulsion. And then when Jarir arrived to the city, you know what he told the man? He saw that the head of the tribe was a man who played with the arrows to give bad and good omens and things like that. Back in time, today when you flip a coin, sometimes you want to do something and you don't want to do something. Instead of thinking it over, you take a coin and you say, okay, I'm going to do that. If it's head, I do it. If it's tail, I don't do it. Worst, some people would say, okay, if it's head, Allah wants me to do it. If it's tail, Allah doesn't want me to do it. And of course, that is a lie and that is shirk. Because if you flip it and it comes tail, who tells you that it is Allah who tells you that? But believe me or not, people do it. And playing with or doing it with the arrows, you're doing it with anything. The same thing. All right? So, but anyhow, so he tells this man, Jarir, the companion, the man that the messenger has sent, tells the head of the tribe, if the messenger of Allah was present here, and if he should get hold of you, he would chop off your neck. Subhanallah. Because of that idol, he would do this? Yeah. That's why Muslims today are violent. They can't reason. You talk to him and straight away, you're kafir, kill him. They can't. One day, as they knocked down the house, they did everything. One day, Jarir, this companion with his army, they're still in there with the tribe to ensure everybody is sticking to the line. He saw the man, the chief of the tribe, again playing with his arrows to foretell something. A man has always lived like this. You don't expect him. We turn to him with 150 warriors and suddenly you expect him to change. But, so Jarir, this companion, saw the man doing the same thing. He went to him and said to him, break them arrows and testify, forcing him with sword to his neck, that none has the right to be worshipped except Allah, or else I will chop off your neck. So the man broke those arrows and testified that none has the right to be worshipped except Allah. Upon completion of this shaitanic, devilish mission, he sent, Jarir, the companion, sent another man to the messenger with this message, O messenger of Allah, by whom who sent you with the truth, I did not leave it, i.e. the house of the idol, till it was like a scabby camel. You see, camels, when they are healthy and nice, they have their fur, their skin, everything is perfectly well. But if the camel is sick and his skin has got tons of fleas and they eat it away, it becomes sick and it has all these buttons. It's really very horrible to look at. He meant he leveled the ground, that idol, he leveled the ground with it and turned the place upon which it was built as a barren, savage land. Upon hearing this good news, the hadith says, the Prophet blessed the horses and the knights of Ahmas. This was the tribe, five times. Bukhari, Muslim, and things like that. These are just two examples from hundreds which have been invented after the death of the messenger with one sole purpose: to legitimize attacks on people just because their beliefs were different to those of the Arabs. It is, my dear sisters and my brothers, with this type of hadith narratives that whole tribes, cities, countries, continents have been attacked and taken to war under the pretext of you believe in Allah or else, which we Muslims translate, they open the land, al-futuhat al-islamiyah, the Islamic opening the land. So they don't call them the conquest, because conquest is colonization. They just kind of like, they open the lanes and we took Allah to them. Who told you to take Allah to them? Allah didn't tell us to go ahead, take my Quran to all mankind and force them to learn Arabic or translate my Arabic Quran to them, because even though the Quran was revealed in Arabic, now I'm telling you the Quran, the meanings of the Quran in English. But anyhow, there is another hadith as well that is at the foundation and core of what's being preached today and why the Arabs did what they did. This hadith is absolutely incredible. It really makes the Quran superfluous. It makes the Quran of no value whatsoever. This hadith is also reported by Bukhari, Muslim, and everybody else, so it's in the highest degree of authenticity. The hadith goes something like this: عجب الله من قوم يدخلون الجنة في السلاسل. Translation of which is, Allah is charmed or fascinated or pleased with a people who will enter paradise chained by chains. What this hadith means is this: the Arabs invaded the country, forced people. You chain somebody just to force them not to move or to do what they want them, right, to do. So Allah is kind of like, wow, these people were actually going to enter Jannah forced in chains by the other Muslims who conquered their lands, killed their husbands, killed their wives, killed their brothers, killed their sisters. They did what they did to force them to believe in me. What a beautiful people, these Muslims. They kill to believe so that other people believe in me. Wonderful people. In another narration also, who will be led to paradise in chains. Even though in the Quran, look, the beauty of the Quran says no compulsion religion. If Allah wanted to force humanity, he could have done it and everyone would have become believing in no time, in a split of a second. But Allah didn't do that. But this is what hadith narratives have done to our Islam. They turned us savages in the name of God, and then we blame why the Jews do, why Christians do, why Hare Krishna do, why the Rohingya people are being so killed by the Buddhists and all that. All they have to do is bring this kind of text to you. This is your Islam. This is, all right, here you go. That's your Islam. That's your mercy. Who you are? You are an assassin who force people into your own beliefs. But that is not what Allah said. That is what the hadith narratives that have been invented by pure humans in the 3rd century, almost 250 years later. And then they said, Muhammad said. Of course, Muhammad said. He's dead, he can't defend himself. But on Judgment Day, these liars shall see. You see, they use these hadith narratives to force people into Islam, and Allah says the Quran, the message of Islam, is in Arabic and was meant only for the Arabs. So if you took this Islam to Indians or to Chinese who do not speak Arabic, then what? How do you expect them to believe the way Allah wants them to when they actually depend on you, how you can translate to them what Allah wants? So you become like an envoy of Allah. And this is the problem we're facing today. The huge majority, great portion of Muslims are not Arabs, and they rely on translations to understand what Allah wants of them. What is the Quran in Arabic in all this? None. The Quran was meant only for Arabs, for those who speak Arabic. Look at it today. Look at the geography in 2021, in the 21st century. Look everywhere Islam was taken by the sword. Muslims today are very touchy when you tell them Islam was spread by the sword. They go, no, it was peacefully. Merchants, no, this is a lie. Islam was taken with the sword. It was taken at the head of the spear. Go to Northern Africa from Morocco all the way to Egypt and ask about their history. The amount of bloodshed is incredible. The amount of beautiful virgin girls taken from the Amazigh people to the indigenous of North Africa, as they like to relate to us, to Muslim. God, in the first year after the conquest of North Africa, Morocco, Algeria, Tunisia, over 90,000 beautiful young virgin girls were taken to Damascus, sold as slaves and captives of war. You tell me Islam wasn't spread, but I can sit here and give you talk after talk after talk. Bring me one continent, one country, one thing where Islam was just like that. People just loved it. No way. And the two narratives that I just told you are a good example. I have been ordered to go to war against anyone who does not believe in Allah. That's why, my dear sisters, the conflict about Palestinian. You see, when the messenger of Allah was alive, he didn't claim the Holy Land. He didn't say, oh, the Holy Land is part of the Muslim heritage and this is our land. Everyone at the time of the messenger until he died knew that the Jews, along with other nations, have lived in that part of the world. It was politics later on, from the time of Umar, which chased the Jews just because they are Jews and claimed the Holy Land as a Muslim land out of nowhere. You see, a small number of people who once lived there, which today are called the Palestinians, they lived with the Jews. Today they claim full ownership of Palestine as theirs. Wasn't Jesus a Jewish who was born in Jerusalem? Wasn't Dawood a Jewish man who lived in Jerusalem? Wasn't Suleiman a Jew and he built his empire, his kingdom, his everything in Jerusalem? Wasn't Miriam and her mother and the birth of Jesus happened in Jerusalem? Wasn't Yahya and Zechariah? I can sit here and name was it. Didn't Allah say in Al-Quran that he has written the Holy Land to the children of Israel? When Allah took the children of Israel from Egypt, where did he take them to? But for us Muslims, no, we don't believe like that. What the Muslims believe is that, and I heard it and it was taught to us at the university, I swear to Allah, it's what they believe. They believe any place on earth where Islam has ruled, even if it is for one day, that land becomes Islamic, and it is the right of Muslims and the duty of Muslims to get it back. And books have been written about how Spain is a Muslim land and it must be retaken back from Spanish people. This is why the Spanish government doesn't want Spain to build any mosques, because of these kind of threats. And when they don't allow, say, human rights, you want to worship? No! It's because of our sick beliefs that we believe because Islam has existed in a piece of land, it becomes Muslims and it is ours. You see, books of histories tell us that in year 15 Hijri, and always when with this number, take always 10 years away. You see, the Prophet Muhammad died in year 10 from his own Hijrah. because the Hijri calendar begins from when he migrated, not from he died. But anyhow, so in year 15, which means 5 years after the death of the Prophet Muhammad, the second president, and I call him president, I don't call him the Khalifa, because Khalifa makes the issue religious. He's the successor of Prophet Muhammad, meaning he acts on how the Prophet Muhammad should have acted. No, Umar ibn Khattab was not a Khalifa. Yes, they attack us Shia. I'm not a Shia. I'm just saying it as it is. And I hate how the Shia have politicized also the thing. Umar ibn al-Khattab was a president, just like Abu Bakr, like Uthman, like anyone who can. But of course, to make people submit to these people, they always tell them he is Khalifa. And it stayed like that for 1400 years until the Turkish lost it all. But now in Saudi Arabia, how do they call the king? They don't call it. You never ever hear anyone called the king of Saudi Arabia as king. Or the crown, you know how they call them? The servant of the two holy shrines. Khadim al-Haramain al-Sharifain. He is the caretaker of the two holy shrines. Do you know why? Because it's religious. They want you always to link the man to Al-Makkah and Al-Madinah. It always is the same trick. These people are president. They are ruthless kings that will kill anyone who gets close to their throne. It is Umar ibn al-Khattab, the second president of the newly born Arab Islamic state or country, whatever. Umar ibn al-Khattab, they said, sent his armies to where? To take the Holy Land from the Jews and Christians who live there. For your information, Jerusalem was circled and surrounded for a total of 4 months. Until the inhabitants of Jerusalem, Jews, Christians, Romans, and everyone, were about to perish and were forced to settle for peace talks, etc. The conquest of the Holy Lands were purely imperial, expanding, getting bigger for the state rather than anything else. Even what they call today the Holy Al-Aqsa Mosque was built around 80 years later from the death of Rasulullah. If the Messenger of Allah didn't do it, it was not religious. Anyhow, the story goes on, and that's why the children of Israel, the Jews today, they tell you, look, we were there, we are a majority, what's wrong with you? Read the Quran, but no. And you know, one of the biggest lies is today they tell you, oh, you know what? The Jews of today are not the Jews of before. They're not the Jews that Allah talks about. So are you telling me also that the Arabs of today are not the Arabs of before? The Meccans of today are not? But anyhow, this is why the Messenger of Allah will get extremely angry with the Arabs, specifically for the Arabs, for deliberately ignoring the Quran. And Allah has reported to us something which the Arabs should have paid a huge attention to. And that is the testimonial that the Messenger of Allah shall make against them on Judgment Day. وَقَالَ الرَّسُولَ And Allah tells us, and on Judgment Day, when the Messenger would say, Ya Rab, O Lord, He didn't say, O Rabbi, i.e. my Lord. On Judgment Day, Allah is the Lord of everybody. No exception. O Lord. Okay. Muhammad will be close to the Quran, or maybe will hold it in hand, because the article used here is for something close. This, not that. He is in the this. And he said, indeed, certainly, truly, my own people, the Arabs, and then anyone who believes after them, have deliberately meant to discard this Quran. You can read about this in Surah Al-Furqan, Surah 25, in the Ayah 30. Again, Islam should never, ever have left the Arabian Peninsula. But it did. And it was taken at sword points, at army's points, at believe or I kill you. Almost 15 centuries of history witness to that. Hadith narratives witness that the sheikhs and the preachers and they don't tell you, they lie in your face, even if the hadith lies. The Quran says no compulsion, and the hadith says I was ordered to kill people. Allah tells Muhammad, Allah is capable of making the entire earth believe and he is not going to do it, are you the one who's going to do it? The hadith tells you, Muhammad has received the order from Allah, keep fighting until the entire earth becomes Muslim. What kind of a joke is this Islam? This is why the only authority, the only truth that Allah shall hold us accountable to is the Qur'an. Not of this senseless, not this hadith. Alhamdulillah, we came face to face with al-Islam. But al-Islam was never meant for me and for you. Because Muhammad, had he spoken Arabic, you, who is listening to my talk right now, would be excluded. Because Allah has sent the Quran in Arabic through an Arab man to an Arab people. This is why Allah speaks to the Quraysh people and to the Arabian Peninsula. He said that he has made the Quran Arabic, in Arabic, so that you understand. You, the poor lady or the poor man who has no clue what the Arabic says, why should Allah hold you responsible? This is why I'm telling you now, to close my talk, enjoy your life. You are in good. Al-Islam was not meant for you, but you are Muslim, you're doing your best. Believe me, on Judgment Day, you shall receive great good deeds. Allah is far more merciful than you think He is. The reason why Islam was abandoned, the reason why Islam was used, it's just one simple thing: expansion. You see, when Banu Umayyah, Muawiyah, took the control of that burgeoning, its small, young empire that was born, the Arab Islamic Empire, they needed an income. They needed an income. What is the best way to get? Go to European countries and ask them, why did the French go to Spain, to invade North Africa? Why do big superpowers invade other countries? It's to take what is good in the other countries. That's all there is to it. The Muslims did exactly the same thing. Not a single place on earth that was invaded by Muslims stayed good. Look at the Muslim world today. Show me one part of that world that has had good influence by the Arabs when they took Islam. None. All of them are backward. None of them is chaotic. Everywhere injustice is. Everywhere corruption is. And all this, Islam is used to justify the doings of the kings, and the guardians of such thing are the Salafis. And that's why I always say Salafism is a cancer that eats in the heart of this beautiful Islam. Before I end this extremely disturbing talk, hopefully, which will serve inshallah in the future, someone might say, Ya akhi, there is an ayah in the Quran where Allah says, وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَاكَ إِلَّا كَافَةً لِلنَّاسِ بَشِيرًا وَنَذِيرًا وَلَكِنَّ أَكْثَرَ النَّاسِ لَا يَعْلَمُونَ. An ayah in Surah Saba. The Surah Saba is the Surah number 34. And the ayah is the ayah 28, which says, and we have not sent you except to all mankind as a bringer of good news and a warner. But a great number of people do not know. This ayah, like many others, has been misused and abused. And the meaning of it has been twisted to mean just what they want us to believe, that the Messenger of Allah was sent to all mankind, even though all mankind didn't speak Arabic. That is the golden rule. We do not send a messenger except with the language of his people. Allah would not contradict himself in one, and he says, I only send you to the people who speak your language, and then he says, I'm sending you to all mankind. And then he makes it our duty to take it to mankind. But Allah is talking to Muhammad, arsalnaka. He's not talking to the believers, arsalnakum, you believers, I'm sending you all. He's talking to Muhammad, I'm sending you. But the true meaning of that ayah, وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَاكَ إِلَّا كَافَةً, it's in the reading. It's in the reading of the ayah, which will change the meaning completely. Allah says, وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَاكَ إِلَّا كَافَةً, and we have not sent you, Muhammad, except as an ender. كَافَ i.e. تَكُفْ, you end something. Meaning Allah had sent the Prophet Muhammad at the end of the chain of messengers to end the big chain of warners and messengers that Allah has sent to mankind. And he is to the people who lived with him only a deliverer of good news and a warner. But a lot of the people in his time, those who lived with him, do not know that Allah had sent Muhammad as the end of the messengers. And he is talking to the Jews exactly because they're still awaiting that Allah will send another Messiah, another someone, prophet that will come. They denied Jesus, they denied Muhammad, they're awaiting somebody else. But Allah is telling them Muhammad is kaffa. Kaffa in Arabic, kaffa meaning the end. The hand, my hand, is called al-kaff. Al-kaff is the one that ends. Muhammad is kaffa, i.e. the ender of the line of messengers, and he is to the people he was sent to a bringer of good news and a warner. But the majority of people in his time didn't believe in that, and this is why when the messenger of Allah died, the majority of the Arabs did not believe in him. I will close now my talk with the messenger being a mercy to mankind. And this is an ayah that almost all Muslims know by heart every time they say, oh, a messenger of Allah is a mercy to mankind. Really? Do you really believe that the messenger who says that he has been ordered to go to war against all mankind until he forces them to believe, even though Allah says there is no compassion, is really a mercy to mankind? How can the messenger of Allah be a mercy to mankind when he is dead now? Where is he? How can he benefit mankind when he is buried many feet under and is locked down in his grave very well? No one can access him, and there is no way. How could Allah make such a claim that he is a mercy to mankind, knowing that his messenger is going to die and humanity won't have any benefit from him? How could the messenger be a mercy when he is at war until he forces people to believe? How can someone be a mercy? If America brought its fleet and planes and wars and it said to us, I am a mercy to you and I will kill you all to your last until you believe in the democracy as I see it because I am a mercy to you. Does that gel with you? It doesn't gel with me. Or did Allah mean something else that the sheikhs have played with for political reason? As it turns out, Allah meant something totally different to what is generally believed. And to understand what Allah meant and his intent, let's go back one ayah before this, we have sent you as a mercy to mankind, and one ayah after it, because the context of this, the meaning of this ayah is within these three ayat. Allah starts by saying, إِنَّ فِي هَذَا لَبَلَاغًا لِقَوْمٍ عَابِدِينَ. Allah, after having spoken to the children of Israel and invited them to believe in this religion, and in the Qur'an and Muhammad, he tells them, surely in this, i.e. in this Qur'an, is a sufficient notice for those devoted to worship. The Jews were worshiping Allah the way they did it. Christians were worshiping Allah the way they did it. So Allah is telling them, you are worshippers already. So why not take the Qur'an, since in it is sufficient notice? I've told you what I want in the Qur'an. And then Allah says, وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَاكَ إِلَّا رَحْمَةً لِلْعَالَمِينَ. For we have not sent you, speaking to Muhammad here, but as a mercy to the realms, to the worlds. What world is Allah on about? Muhammad lived just in his time, in his world. And then to understand this, let's carry on. قُلْ, do tell them, Ya Muhammad, say, إِنَّمَا يُوحَى إِلَيْهِ, I only receive revelation. And that revelation states that your ilah, the deity to worship, is only one mono god, one single god. فَهَلْ أَنْتُمْ مُسْلِمُونَ, are you then going to submit to him and become a Muslim? When I say I am a Muslim, it only just means I have submitted to God, just like Jews, like Christians, like so many others. These three ayat really opens the gates to Allah's bounties of endless mercy, both in this life and in the life to come. You see, in the world to come after resurrection occurs, people will get split into two groups. Those who submitted to Allah and those who didn't submit to Allah. Those who will enjoy Allah's mercy on Judgment Day are those who are willing to obey and worship Him in their best possible way in this life. All what Allah wants of them is that they believe in Him, being mono, being individual, single. And the other part is to submit to Him what He says you do, what He says you don't. And with the Qur'an, Allah doesn't ask much of us. What the Qur'an is doing is this. It's calling for these two elements in all their simplicity, i.e. believe in Allah, follow what Allah says that you should do. Any human who worships Allah and submits to Him with the knowledge that they are doing this, expecting rewards on Judgment Day, guess what? They are safe from Allah's punishment. This is why Abdullah ibn Abbas said, as is reported in At-Tabari and other books of tafsir, when he came to this ayah that we have sent you except as a mercy to mankind, he said, من آمن بالله واليوم الآخر كتب له الرحمة في الدنيا والآخرة. Whosoever believed in Allah and the last day shall be written mercy in this life and in the hereafter. This is the meanings of the Quran that they don't tell you. The true meaning of this ayah, therefore, is this. Since Allah used the verb send to Muhammad, He didn't say, Ya Muhammad, you, He said, Arsalnaka, we sent you only as a mercy to the realms, to all the worlds. Then there is a message with which the Prophet, the messenger, was sent. That message is the Quran. And in the Quran, as we know, that is with us today, Allah has reduced the criteria to enter in Jannah to only believe in Him and the end, the last day of judgment. Therefore, the mercy here is the Quran, not Muhammad. Look at it this way. Imagine you are a king or a queen, and you are in a war against some people for whatever reason. They didn't give you cookies, so you decided to launch war against them. And then as these people were going through hardships, what you do, you call one of your messengers and you write a book, and in that book, in that decree, you say, I, the king or queen, therefore, I am stopping the war against these people. Not only that, I'm going to reward them, and we're going to pay back all the damages, and I'm going to honor them, and I'm going to build for each one of them a house and give them 100 camels. That's the message. And then you write it and you give it to the messenger. And you say to your messenger, come here, take this message. I am going to send you as a mercy to those people. No one in their right mind would say that the person of the messenger is the mercy. Everyone would understand that the message carried by the messenger is the mercy. This is why the mercy here is the Quran, not Muhammad. Muhammad is dead. He cannot be a mercy. The only mercy left for mankind is the Quran. End of it. But here, it's not mankind as a whole. It's for those who speak Arabic, because you always remember, Allah doesn't send a messenger except in the language of their people. So now the question is, what about you who speak English and me? And the other one else, guess what? We are in the bonus. We are in the bonus. Quran speaks to us in Arabic. We don't know Arabic. We're doing our best. We already believe in Allah on the last day. The mercy has been written for us. Our job is to die on this mercy. Stick to the Quran. You never go wrong. This is why Islam was not for you or for me or for anyone else that was not Arab. It was for the Arabs. And on Judgment Day, we shall see for what they did. The assassinations, the murders, the killings, all this. And then if you don't accept Islam, they make you pay a tax in spite of your nose. It's either you believe in Allah or you pay a tax. That's why people fight Islam. And I understand why the world is against Islam. And I accept what they do, because we have to curb Salafism. We have to curb this blood shedding. This I ordered to go to war against anyone who doesn't believe in Allah and Muhammad's messenger. We have to go back to the beauty of Islam. No compulsion. You want to drink, drink. You want to fornicate, fornicate. I'm not your God. What if you fornicated your entire, you're a porn star. And then before you die, you say, La ilaha illallah, and Allah forgives you. What's the big headache? But anyhow, this no one gets to talk about it, because as soon as someone talks about it, they are, especially the sheikhs, they will be like saying, oh, you know what, for the last 1500 years, Muslims got it all wrong. This, they will never admit to, even though that is the truth. Again, this is your brother Abdusalam, and I pray to Allah this opens your eyes furthermore and makes you love Al-Quran and love Allah and love the Messenger even more, and despise that hadith narratives and the big joke that they played on us. Time to clean our Islam back and claim it back. Alrighty? Yalla, you have a wonderful day, and Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah.